this lecture, we're going to go back all the way to the beginning, or at least as close to the beginning as we can possibly get. We're going to ask the question, how far back in time does our physics extend to the very beginnings of the universe and the Big Bang? We're going to explore the universe in its earliest phases in a lecture I call The First 3 Minutes. The universe we see today is cold, dark, and low density. We see hundreds of billions of galaxies out to billions of light years away from us in all directions. But it didn't always look this way. 13.8 billion years ago, the universe was small, dense, and hot enough to be opaque. When the universe was 380,000 years old, it suddenly became transparent to light, producing the cosmic background radiation that we see today. This red and blue map that you see here in the middle of the screen is the best map to date made of small fluctuations in temperature seen in the cosmic microwave background. We're seeing the universe as it was when it was only 380,000 years old. How far back, however, can we go in cosmic history? How far back does our knowledge of state-of-the-art physics press, and how close can we get to the very beginnings of everything at the very start of the Big Bang? To understand what governs the physics as we go back into the hotter, denser phases of the universe, we need to introduce the concept of binding energy. Binding energy is the energy that is needed to break apart or unbind different forms of matter. It often helps to express binding energy as an equivalent binding temperature at which different forms of matter become unbound and melt. Many of us find it easier to think in terms of temperature rather than energy expressed in some unit like joules or electron volts, because we have at least an everyday human scale notion of hot and cold. So too, we can use temperature as a stand-in for energy, because temperature and energy are just different ways of expressing the same thing. Here are four different states of matter, their relevant size scales, and the typical binding temperatures. Atoms consist of electrons bound to atomic nuclei. Their typical size scale is 10 to the minus 10 meters, and they become unbound. The electrons are stripped away from the nuclei when the temperature exceeds the binding temperature of about 1,000 degrees Kelvin. For example, when we talked about the cosmic microwave background, the universe became transparent when the temperature dropped below about 3,000 degrees Kelvin. And electrons could then combine onto hydrogen nuclei, and the universe suddenly became transparent. This number for the binding temperature that I'm going to use is a round number temperature. Atomic nuclei consist of protons and neutrons. They have size scales 4 orders of magnitude smaller than atoms at 10 to the minus 14 meters, and the binding temperature of an atomic nucleus is 10 to the 10 degrees Kelvin, 10 billion degrees Kelvin. Protons and neutrons can actually break apart into quarks. Protons and neutrons are made each of 3 different types of quarks. The typical size scale of a proton and neutron is 10 to the minus 15 meters, and have a binding temperature of about 10 to the 11 degrees Kelvin, 100 billion degrees Kelvin. Finally, the most fundamental form of matter of all, quarks, the individual particles of which all heavy particles are made up, have a size scale 3 orders of magnitude smaller still at 10 to the minus 18 meters, and have binding temperatures of 10 to the 13 degrees Kelvin. When the temperature exceeds 10 to the 13 degrees Kelvin, quarks and antiquarks come into equilibrium with photons, and we no longer have stable quarks existing. The quarks melt into a sea of mass energy, is a way of thinking about it. For example, atoms ionize into ions and electrons at about 3,000 degrees Kelvin. Nuclei in the cores of massive stars begin to melt when the temperature exceeds about 10 billion degrees Kelvin. If you remember back to Unit 2, when we talked about the evolution of massive stars, it was when the core of the star reached 10 billion degrees that the nuclei began to melt and hastened the start of the collapse that led to a supernova. The idea of binding energy is derived from each of the 4 fundamental forces of nature. We're used to a couple of these forces on everyday scales. The gravitational force is the weakest force of nature. It acts to bind masses together at very long range. Planets are bound to stars, Stars are bound into galaxies, and galaxies are bound to other galaxies within clusters and superclusters throughout the universe. Gravity is probably the one force we have the most everyday encounter with. If you jump up, gravity pulls you back down. The electromagnetic force is the other force we have everyday experience of. It is about 10 to the 36 times stronger than gravity, and it acts to bind atoms and molecules together. Our experience of the electromagnetic force, in many ways, is much more personal. We are held together by the electromagnetic force. The weak nuclear force is about 10 to the 25 times stronger than gravity, and the strong nuclear force is about 10 to the 38 times stronger than gravity, are the two forces that work on very small scales, on nuclear scales. The weak nuclear force is the force fundamentally behind many forms of radioactivity in nuclei. The neutron being unstable, breaking into protons and electrons, is a manifestation of the action of the weak nuclear force. The strong nuclear force is the force that binds protons and neutrons together into atomic nuclei. The range of this force, both the weak and the strong nuclear force, are examples of what are called short-range forces. They do not occur on scales of human beings or on the scales of rooms. They occur only on the scales of the atomic nucleus. They have ranges of activity between 10 to the minus 15 and 10 to the minus 18 meters. On those scales, the weak and strong nuclear force dominate over all other forces on the problem. When I go up to atomic scales, the electromagnetic force is strong, and it continues to stay strong even to the scale of people and large objects. Lightning is a good example of the electromagnetic force in action. Finally, the gravitational force works on the very largest scales of all, scales extending all the way up to the universe itself on large scales. At very high energies, our current models of physics show that the physical behaviors of the four fundamental forces begin to merge or unify together. All of the important milestones in the evolution of the hot, dense, early universe are going to occur at the times of the unification of the various fundamental forces among each other. This diagram that I'm going to show, which looks like a tree, shows the division of all the forces of nature. In the present day, here we are at the extreme right of the diagram. The temperature of the universe is about 3 degrees Kelvin, 3 degrees above absolute zero. And we live in a universe in which there is gravity, the electromagnetic force, and the strong and weak nuclear force. But this was not always the case. As we go into the past, as we go to the left in this diagram, the temperature will increase, and at various temperatures, we will see that some of these forces will begin to merge together into a smaller number of fundamental forces or interactions. Many of the major milestones of the universe will occur when these changes in the interaction among the four fundamental forces occur. This is part of what allows us to push our ideas of physics further and further back in time. What's the story of the evolution of the universe from as far back as our physics works? Let's go. The very first place we can talk about in the beginning of the universe is not time t equals zero, but a time that occurred 10 to the minus 43 seconds afterwards, when we enter what is called the Planck Epoch. The Planck Epoch is when all the four fundamental forces of nature are unified into a single superforce. There is no gravity, weak force, electromagnetic force, or strong force as separate entities, each working with their separate interactions on their separate scales. All the forces are unified into one. Everything in the universe is packed together. The temperature exceeds 10 to the 32 degrees Kelvin, and all of the forces act as one superforce. We can't say too much about what the universe is like at this scale because we do not yet have a good quantum theory of gravity. We do not know how to incorporate gravity with the strong, electromagnetic, and weak forces, all three of which have reasonably good descriptions in the quantum theory. As a consequence, we don't really know in detail what goes on, but what we can say is that space-time as we understand it today would have emerged from whatever the Big Bang was at the end of the Planck Epoch. Before the Planck Epoch, with gravity combined in and unified with the weak, strong, and electromagnetic forces, our notions of space-time today would have been very, very different. How different? We really won't know until we can crack the puzzle of the quantum description of gravity. But this epoch does not last very long. By the time the 10 to the minus 43 second Planck era ends, when the temperature reaches about 10 to the 32 degrees Kelvin, gravity separates from the superforce, and now there are two forces at work in the universe, gravity and a combination of the strong, weak, and electromagnetic force called the Grand Unified theory, or gut force. The strong and electroweak forces are all still unified, and the universe in this gut epoch is a hot, dense soup of photons, quarks, and antiquarks, all in equilibrium. A quark and an antiquark collide, annihilate together, and divide up into two photons carrying away their energy. Two photons of that same energy colliding will suddenly pop a quark-antiquark pair out of the vacuum. Before those quarks and antiquarks could do anything interesting, like form some other particles, they will quickly annihilate and turn back into photons. The entire universe is a soup of matter coming in and out of existence with gravity. Space-time, as we understand it, is now fully formed, at least we think it is. You never know with this stuff. It's really early in the universe. But matter, as we understand it, has not yet emerged. We're still a hot, dense soup of energy and matter changing back and forth in form. This changes at 10 to the minus 35 seconds at a temperature of 10 to the 27 degrees Kelvin when we enter the inflationary epoch. The inflationary epoch begins when the strong force separated from the gut force. At this point, there are now three forces in the universe: gravity, the strong nuclear force, and the unified electromagnetic and weak force that we call the electroweak force. At this phase, we end up with three forces, and there's a rapid separation of the electromagnetic and strong force triggers a rapid exponential growth in the size scale of the universe. This rapid exponential growth is so fast, it is called inflation. In the inflationary epoch, the universe grew exponentially by a factor of almost 10 to the 26, between 10 to the minus 36 and 10 to the minus 32 seconds from the Big Bang. It started out very small and very compact, but at 10 to the minus 35 to 36 seconds, it suddenly blew up enormously in scale and began the general slow expansion that we now see today. Before the inflationary epoch, we only have, at best, speculation on what the physics was. But after the inflationary epoch, the universe is more and more beginning to resemble a very hot, very dense version of the type of universe we see today, not only in terms of contents, but in particular in terms of scale. It's what we would expect if we took the current day expansion and scale of the universe and ran it backwards in time. We would end up at a very early time, 10 to the minus 45 seconds, with the universe being a lot larger than it actually was. So our real knowledge of physics really starts to begin at the end of the inflationary epoch. What does inflation do for us? Well, one of the things that inflation does is it helps explain why the universe is so nearly perfectly geometrically flat. As we've mentioned in previous lectures, there is a lot of observational evidence to show that we live in a flat, infinite universe, with omega naught approximately equal to 1. Why is it we are almost exactly flat? Because the range of possibilities from high density to low density is enormous. Why did we pick and zero in on exactly flat? The answer, surprisingly, may be that the universe may have had no choice but to be flat because of the action of inflation. Here's why. Let's view the universe in a very simplified form as a steadily expanding sphere. It really isn't, but this is a way to look at the problem of inflation geometrically. When the sphere is small and we look at it on the scale of the sphere, we can see the curvature of the sphere. It's obviously, well, spherical. But now blow it up by a factor of 3. Now, on a local scale of r square, the curvature is a little bit less. Blow it up by another factor of 3 to a factor of 9, and the curvature becomes flatter, And by the time we get to a factor of 3 of times 3, or 27, now the grid lines are looking pretty flat. The curvature is not as obvious. A good example of this every day? Walk outside and look around. We're standing on the surface of a sphere, nearly 13,000 kilometers in diameter. And yet, the Earth doesn't look round to us. The Earth looks flat. Why? Because the scale on which we are able to see is much smaller than the radius of curvature of the universe, or the radius of curvature of the Earth. So too it is with the universe. When we look at the universe today, we see it as nearly flat. Its radius of curvature must be at least 40 billion parsecs, perhaps even more. It is, to all intents and purposes, geometrically flat. So while the universe may have started out in a shape more like the sphere down here, what inflation does is it so rapidly expands the size scale of the universe that it effectively flattens out. It would be very hard to have a flat universe from the beginning, ab initio, in a classic way, without invoking this exponential inflation. This is going to be a very important fact to us, because this inflation is very important for understanding not only why the universe is flat, but why the universe has structure. Structures that are important because those structures gave birth to stars, planets, and ultimately to us. And that's what we'll pick up in the next lecture.